Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Great to gather together this morning in a time of worship, and great to hear the hubble and bubble of conversation going on. Please do continue that later on. If you're joining us for the first time, you're very welcome. My name's Kevin. I'm the pastor here. And do join in as you feel most comfortable as we seek to praise our Lord Jesus. And also, if you're not connected with us in any way, then do grab one of these red cards from the lobby, fill it out, leave it near the door, and we'll get you connected up with the various emails that we send out, keeping you informed as to what we do each week. But we come here today to praise the Lord Jesus. And the psalmist writes in 111, "Praise the Lord. I will extol the Lord with all my heart, in the council of the upright and in the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord. They are pondered by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic are his deeds, and his righteousness endures forever." Let's pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this opportunity to freely gather together this morning, whether we're in person or online. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are present with us right now. Help us to have hearts that are open to praising you, to hearing your word, to being changed. May we bring glory to you through all that we do today. And as we sing our opening songs, Lord, bringing praise to who you are, recognizing you in all of creation and know in majesty in the person of Jesus, Lord, would you convict us again of those truths and realign us to praise your holy name. Amen. So if you're able, let's stand and sing two songs of praise together.
I see the stars, I hear the mighty
loving God, we thank you for Jesus. Our Jesus, our Savior. Lord, there is none like you. Lord, we thank you that when we look into creation, it speaks of someone, something above all things. Thank you that you have revealed yourself to us in creation. But you didn't leave it there, Lord. By your grace, you brought the person of Jesus Christ, fully God to earth, to show us what it is to live at peace with you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we are those who have seen his glory, that we know his sacrifice, and that we receive forgiveness because of what he did upon the cross. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, my Jesus and my Savior, because, Lord, there is none like you. Jesus, for the promises that we find in you. Thank you for your word, which reveals who you are, that leads us into truth, that opens that place where we encounter those promises, which to each is the answer, yes. Thank you, Lord, that whether we've been going through hard times or things have been going well, you have been present. And your love continues no matter what. Father, forgive us where we have ignored you, where we have spoken out of turn, where we have thought out of turn, where, Lord, we have in our own ways led our own lives. Lord, we come before you with our hearts broken, but knowing that through confession and choosing to turn and walk back into relationship with you, we are forgiven. We are held safe in your hands. Praise you, Jesus. Lift off us any guilt that we may sense, because that is not what you teach, that we are free in you. Thank you for you, Jesus, the living hope of all things. Amen. Amen. Do sit down. And Anna and Charlie, come on up. So normally we would do this moment during communion, but being as Charlie, I think today, is out helping with our children's work, we're going to do this moment now. We are not a group of rules. We are flexible in this church. We're going to make it work. And this is about membership. Okay, so Charlie and Anna applied to become members of... they can come up as well if they want. It's not a problem. Whatever you want to do. To become members of Castle Hill, which in the very simple summary means they're all in. They're choosing to commit themselves to here, to use their gifts and skills as life circumstances allow, to use their resources as life allows. Let me give you one of those. I know you're so happy with that, but don't panic. It's just it's not going to bite. Okay. We as Castle Hill gather as members to discern what God is saying to us. Sometimes we have to go through stuff about policies and procedures. Yes, but what we really are seeking in, with any of that stuff, is to be a church which is able to share Jesus with anyone we meet, to be hope in Warwick and beyond, a beacon of hope. And so we're delighted that you want to become members, and today we want to welcome you formally into membership. And so I'm going to ask you a question, of which the answer hopefully is I will, or we will, and then I'm going to ask the members to respond to questions as well. So it's our practice to make the following simple promises in public before one another and in the presence of God. And so Charlie and Anna, will you share with us in this common life and service, and will you covenant to walk together with us before God in ways that are known and yet to be made known?
We will.
Thank you. If you are a church member, so you've come into membership, would you please stand with me? And we have a we do and a we will, okay? They're the two we're holding for. So, as members, do we welcome Charlie and Anna into the fellowship of this covenanting, worshipping community, accepting them as a gift from God, committing to help them use their gifts of ministry to witness for him? And will we support them in their Christian service and in their responsibilities of church membership by encouraging them through hospitality, friendship, partnership, and prayer?
We will.
Then, Charlie and Anna, I offer you the right hand of fellowship, welcoming you into Castle Hill membership. Let's give them a round of applause. Don't head off just yet. That's great, and let's pray for them now, shall we? Thank you, Father of God, for Charlie and Anna, for Sammy and Jonathan. Thank you that you have brought them here at this time, for this season, and that they have chosen to become members of Castle Hill. Lord, would you bless them? Would you keep them? Would you help them to know that you're watching over them always? And would you help us to be people who encourage them so that they might grow more in their relationship with you? Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Do sit down. So as Castle Hill, we want to be people who are sharing God's love in different ways. We've got two of those to talk about today. And we've got a verse which reminds us as to why this is important for us, that we're not just doing this because we're nice people. But 1 John chapter 3, verse 18 says this. And if you're able to read it, would you read it with me, please? Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. Do you hear that? So not just words, but also through how we act. And of course, that's not saying we want to put on someone what we think they should act like. This is our response to God. Yeah, so because Jesus loves us, we want to respond in certain ways. We choose to serve other people. Sometimes that's hard, isn't it? Because they might not do what we want them to do, and that's just tension. And we have to live with that. We trust God is going to work that through for us. But he's given us so many things. He's given us everything. Yeah, we are so blessed. And we remember that at harvest. And one of the ways that we can respond to him coming up is our harvest appeal. Now, if you haven't been part of Castle Hill for long, you won't know that we have a couple of appeals throughout the year. So we invite you to regularly give. Some people see it as tithing. Other people see it in a different way. That's fine, however you see it. And there's ways that you can do that. But this is outside of that. This is an addition. This is a thanksgiving offering to say, thank you, Lord, for the ways that you have blessed me this year. And we have an all-age service on the 1st of October, and that will be when we launch that opportunity for you to give. Most of you will do it online, I'm sure, but you can do it in person as well. And money doesn't go to Castle Hill. We give it away. We want to show our love for those around the world who need help. And so we're looking to Operation Agri, a Christian organization who works in various countries in this particular appeal. They're working in Tanzania, helping to transform farming communities so that they can be self-sustaining and so that they can then also live a better life. But they are being given that through Christian love. They're being supported. There's opportunity for them to respond to the gospel as well in time. And we also take a local charity, and that this year is the Farming Community Network. We've got a speaker coming to Cameo in a couple of months' time, linked with them, one of their chaplains, working again in quite a difficult cultural atmosphere, in a pressurized work environment, and seeking to love them and to support them and encourage them as people walking with Jesus. And so this is one way that we can respond. So we look at our bank accounts and we think, actually, you know what? What can we give? What is God saying to us? Because God loves a cheerful giver. Yeah? He really does. He wants you to do it from your heart, not because Kevin's standing up here saying it. Okay? So that's coming up. You see it in the newsletter, and we'll tell you about that on the 1st. And even if you're not here, there's ways that you can give on that date. So that's one way, money. Okay, money can hold us, but actually we can turn it back for good for God. Here's another way that we can respond, and it involves one of these. Yeah, who knows what this is? A shoebox. Absolutely, a shoebox. What on earth could we use a shoebox for? Well, if Pauline was here, if she was a bit better, then she would be up here telling you about it. Vicky would be up here telling you about it, but I've been given the task. Okay? A shoebox, simple thing, but actually it's an opportunity to fill it with gifts of love to an organization called the Amen Trust, who we've supported for a number of years, and we fill it with things which we see as very normal, you know, toothbrushes, toothpaste, a bag of sweets, a little gift, clothes of different kinds. And it's not just aimed at children, it's aimed at the whole family. So whilst they're given to the children, they're designed to bless families in Romania in some of the most poorest areas in the gypsy community. The key thing why we like this is because we know that the workers only give the boxes to those people they are already working with. That's not meaning that they limit where the boxes can go, but it means we know that it's not just a kind of here you go and they're gone. That they are working in these communities to share Jesus' love in a practical way every day Yeah, setting up education centres, supporting them with their health needs. Really practical things which shine the light of Jesus. They are being beacons of hope in those places. And so, we're talking about this in September, I know. But the boxes have to be in by Sunday the 5th of November. Okay? And they will all be wrapped in Christmas paper, which will all feel a bit weird. But that's okay. Now, for most of you, you can download the leaflet, which explains what can go in it and how it works from the website. So our website, /shoebox. And that will then give you the information, how to approach it, and you'll have no problems. If you need a printed copy, we'll get some done for next week. And if you want to say to us on the door, then we can have a kind of guess of numbers as well. We're very happy to do that. We just don't want to print loads and find we're having to throw them away. Okay, so the information about what it means to do this is on the website. Please go there. Please have a look. I want to challenge us, each of us. If you're financially able, please don't feel a burden if you're not. But if you're financially able, it would be fantastic for each of us to do a box. We had over 60 last year. It'd be great to go, let's double that number. Yeah? Let's see if we can have, and as you do them, you can just bring them up and you can just put them on the platform and gradually they'll just start piling up as and when you've done them. Okay? If you have questions, Pauline and Vicky are your people. As you can tell, you don't want to come to me. But I'll just point you to the website. So a great opportunity for all family to get involved, to be going, doing a bit of shopping, and to be looking for opportunities to do that. There is a video on that. We're going to leave it because of time. Okay? So we'll show you a video at another point about the shoeboxes. Right. Base camp was yesterday. Who went? Raise your hands if you went. Don't be shy. I think we had about 8, didn't we? Yep. 9. Okay. It was fantastic. Over 100 young people. Who's going to be brave, young person? Who's going to be brave and come and quickly give us a piece of information? Come on. Someone can share with us what happened. Oh, there's a bit of cajoling going on. Is this on? Nope. But we will get it on, thank you. But no, they're resisting anyway. You weren't there, William, you can't comment. No? Okay, tell me one thing that happened. Shout it out. What happened? They ate burgers, that's true. In fact, I was challenged to try the sausage as well to see which was better. I have to say, I thought the burger was better, but there we go. That solves the problem. Okay, what else happened? Giggles. Yeah, lots of fun, lots of games. Okay, and there was also a time of worship, seeing over 100 people in St. Paul's Church, young people worshiping Jesus was just fantastic. Please be praying for them. Base camp, which is the weekend away, the dates have just come out and we'll get that advertised to you. I know Sarah will be on that, already on it, so that's fantastic. So we want to be praying for our young people, not just for ours, but also for opportunities to speak about these things that are going on so that others can be connected with Jesus. We have got coming up prayer and fasting days. Jesus says, when you fast. Okay, that's very against our culture, I know, but he does say when you fast. And straight away I can feel someone saying, but I can't not eat my food because of health reasons. And that's fine. This fasting, we're not putting it in a box which is just about food. Again, go to the website. I produced a leaflet when we did this last year as well, which talks about the other ways that you can engage in fasting if you can't do food. That's God knows. It's about you and him. But this is an opportunity. It's a good practice for us to spend time intentionally listening to God. Okay? And by giving up something, we are seeking to offer a sacrifice in that space. Okay, we're doing it for a short period of time. We've got 3 dates in September, October, November. They're in the newsletter. But on that Saturday, access to this building will be available through Gateway during the time that Gateway's open. So you can just come in, just let one of the staff know that you're looking for your quiet space to come and pray, to sit with God, and they will happily let you through so you can use it during that time. And then at 6:30, we'll have a Zoom prayers online for those who are, so that wherever you are, you're able to gather and we can pray together as that comes to an end around 7 o'clock. So I want to encourage you, if you've never done it before, to engage with it. If 12 hours feels like a mammoth thing to do for you, please don't put a burden on yourself. Start with something which seems like it is able and go a little bit further as a sacrifice and see what the Lord is saying to you. We'll give you a guide sheet to tell you what we're praying about communally, but it's also just a time for you to spend time with Jesus in an intentional way. And finally, we want to flag up that Tuesday is Cameo, and we've got some history about Battersley Clinton. Got that right way around, haven't I? Yeah, Battersley Clinton coming. So if you're free between 1:30 and 3, then please come along to the lounge, come and have a listen to the talk, come and have some food, enjoy the conversation as well, the good time as a community. It's really a great opportunity. Okay, that'll do for now. I'm going to pray for our children and young people, and then we shall allow them to go to their groups. Thank you, Lord God, that you ask us to respond to your love by pouring that love out on others, by sharing in acts of kindness through our financial giving, through our giving of practical items. Lord, today we've heard a challenge, and so we ask that your Spirit would help our hearts to know how we should respond, what is right to do. Lord, thank you for the opportunities that we have to praise you, to spend time with you. Again, Lord, help us to step into those spaces if they're slightly uncomfortable for us. Lord, still give us the impetus to do it because we love you. And Lord, Father, we want to thank you for our children and young people. We want to thank you for this opportunity this morning for them to go to their groups and to learn more of you as some of us stay in here to continue to study your word. And so we just ask that you would bless them and that they would continue to know your great love for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, so AYP, that age range, you're going down into Gateway today. So if you want to start heading out now, we'll get you at the front of the queue. Just a reminder to parents, if you haven't done the ongoing consent, which was sent out by email, then please can you do that so that we're up to date with our information on your children and we can care for them well. Okay, extreme age, years 2 to year 6, you don't need your parents, so head out into the lobby. And then following them on, our groundbreakers, age 2.5 to year 1, you need your parents because they just don't behave when you walk down the street with them. You've got to hold their hands, got to keep them in order. That would be great. While they're going out, why don't you turn to someone nearby and just greet them and just say hello. Well, do continue those conversations later. Well, last week we started a series, a new series called 10, which was looking at the Ten Commandments found in the book of Exodus. And as we explored the events before the law was given, we saw how the Ten Commandments are part of a covenant agreement between Yahweh, that's the name God gives for himself, and the Israelite people whom by God's grace he rescued from Egypt. And in response to this amazing rescue plan, Yahweh talks directly to them, inviting them into a relationship with him by outlining 10 guiding principles by which they should all live. Now, we might see the Ten Commandments as rather stringent, but for a people who had just been liberated from being highly oppressed slaves under the reign of Pharaoh only 5 months previous, this teaching offers freedom. For the opposite of any kind of law is almost certainly anarchy. And so today we're going to continue to explore the Ten Commandments, and we're going to be reading the first two commandments that Yahweh speaks to his people. And then Maureen's going to read for us from Acts. Okay, so we've got two pages. I would suggest if you're not familiar with your Bible, go to the Acts passage. It's the longer one. So it's going to be the one you can follow easier. And we're gonna have a listen to how the Apostle Paul chose to act when he encountered a place full of idols. So we're looking at Exodus 20, verses 1 to 6, near the front of your Bibles. In mine, it's page 77, around there. And if you need a Bible, or you want to use an app, there's Bibles at the back, on the sides, around chairs, if you haven't got them. And then Acts 17, which is near the back of your Bibles, starting at verse 16. How are we doing? Most people found it? So Exodus 20 first, and then Acts 17. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments.
While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day, with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, "What is this blabber trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Now what you worship as something unknown, I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the earth and be determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others.
Thanks, Maureen. Let's pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart bless your name, Lord Jesus. And may each of our hearts be open to hearing what you have to say to us this day. May we not leave this place unchanged. Amen. Well, I want to tell you about one of my best friends who is a self-proclaimed spiritual person. He's been through a whole sway of different religious practices in search of helping him with his anxiety, his past troubles, and ultimately trying to find peace. And it's funny, isn't it? Because despite being one of his best mates, he is incredibly resistant to the idea of exploring the teachings of Jesus. Now, when we met up recently, he was telling me about the joy he had had of spending 4 weeks in a Buddhist retreat center in Europe somewhere, and in his own words, where he could decompress from the pressures of life and center himself. And I listened, as a friend would, with interest as he described many practices you might also encounter, I think, at a Christian retreat center. Things like daily times of sung worship, eating in community, space for yourself, spiritual guidance from an experienced person, and a gradual increase in peace. I don't think this has anything to do with retreat centers, by the way. A gradual increase in peace as you remove yourself from the pace of the modern world. I also found myself smiling because he also described some of the tensions he encountered with inside this Buddhist community, and they were remarkably similar to what we experience in church, or indeed, I would hasten to add, anywhere you find human beings trying to gather around a common cause and having to wrestle with diverse personalities. Anyway, all was going well in our conversation. I thought I was doing well, dropping in my Jesus hints, but he wasn't biting. And then he said something like this. "You know what, Kev? You should try it. After all, you're all just worshipping the same God, aren't you? You've discovered him in different ways, but he's the same, right?" Well, those who know me know I've got a pretty poor poker face. And he obviously saw that too, because he ran backwards fairly quickly and went, "Or maybe not." You know, this is what our world would like us all to believe and celebrate. That we all worship the same God, just in different expressions. And if you're not involved in a religious organization, which is how they label us, then you know what? I can see how that kind of makes some sense. Because there are definitely aspects of our practices that have common ground for the onlooker. But practice and belief are two very different things. And the Apostle Paul makes a similar point about meat sacrificed to idols in 1 Corinthians 8, if you know that passage, challenging believers to ensure that their freedom in Christ doesn't cause a fellow Christian to stumble just because their conscience allows it. You see, God's common grace may have led us to find a place where, for example, meditation is a generally helpful practice. But what really matters is what happens in that time of meditation and to whom it is focused. Of course, that doesn't fit neatly in a box for our politically correct society who want to insist on a pluralist approach to religion. Comments like the following are commonplace, certainly in places I've been. All religions are one, they say, and whether we call it heaven, nirvana, or paradise, surely you're all heading to the same destination, just under a different name. All religions contribute to the spiritual truth through their aspect of truth. You heard that one? Yeah, we've all got a bit, we haven't got it all. Yeah, or no one religion can claim to be right. They've all got a bit of the light. It's quite a trendy statement, that one. Yeah. See, the problem anyone who makes these comments has is the very words God speaks in Exodus 20, verse 3. You shall have no other gods before me. Or the words that Jesus speaks in John 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then there's the claim of his disciples who were willing to die to proclaim the message about Jesus in Acts 4, 12. Well, that's a bit stupid if it doesn't really matter. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to you by which we must be saved. And even if we really try to be sympathetic and we want to say, you know, people who love God, surely they're saved. We run into the tension of the Roman centurion found in Acts 10, who is described as a God-fearing and righteous man, and yet he needed to hear the good news of Jesus to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Believing in God was not enough. And our world today, friends, is very similar to the world 3,000 years ago. The nation of Israel was surrounded by the lure of many often so-called gods. The Assyrians worshipped Ashur. The Egyptians had Osiris and Iris with their hawk-headed son Horus. You must have encountered these in school somewhere. Yeah. And today, our pluralist society still wants to say, though, that whether you worship Krishna, Buddha, Allah, or Gaia, interesting, Gaia's making a resurgence in cathedrals at the moment. Whether you consult spiritual mediums, horoscopes, chant Hindu mantras, or go to church on a Sunday morning, all are one and all are the same thing. But again, Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 2, verse 5, there is only one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. And Isaiah, speaking on behalf of God, declares, I, even I, am the Lord, and apart from me, there is no Savior. Now, don't get me wrong. I have no problem working alongside people of other faiths to show unity in the face of community need. I have no problem spending time with someone of another religion, talking about faith and loving them for who they are. But friends, it's an insult to any of us to say that we worship the same God or are just sharing an aspect of truth. And whilst we don't have time to dig into the various religions and the differences there, just consider these two. How can reincarnation possibly be squared with the teaching in Scripture, Hebrews 9:27, that there is one death, one judgment, and that's the end? Or how can salvation by personal effort and merit possibly be valid alongside the consistent teaching of Scripture, Ephesians 2, verse 8 to 9, that salvation is a free gift, which is both unearned and undeserved? Friends, Yahweh has always claimed to be the sovereign creator and has proved this by moving in power time and again, not least in coming in the person of Jesus Christ and rising from the dead. He has never hinted that there may be another way to come to him. And thinking of Yahweh in any other way is then to reduce Almighty God into a box, into perhaps how we can see him, or indeed to level him with the gods of the world. And it may be an uncomfortable truth to state in today's pluralist society, but Yahweh claims exclusive rights as the only God, fully united as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And any understanding of other understanding of who he is that doesn't marry up with what is revealed in the Bible is just not worthy of him. This is the God whom we're called to give our undivided allegiance to, having weighed up the cost of whether to follow Jesus or not. And this was the truth the Apostle Paul had come to know and was willing to preach even into that pluralist Greek city of Athens. Taking time to get to know his surroundings, Paul is shocked by the many idols he encounters. That's interesting, isn't it? He's shocked. I wonder how shocked we are. He's shocked. And then he encounters this altar, in the marketplace to an unknown God. Great timing. In sync there. An unknown God. I mean, talk about covering your bases, right? Just in case there's anyone else. Now, the idea of an idol or an image in biblical times, if you don't know, was that it not only represented the God you worshipped, but it also in some way contained something of its presence. Like they thought actually God resided as something of themselves inside this random thing they'd made. And that's why, friends, it's amazing to think that Genesis tells us that we are made in the image of God. People are meant to see something of God in us, and Jesus has told us that God resides in us. Christ in us and us in him, we are filled as temples of the Holy Spirit. Amazing. Back to Paul. And he realizes that by worshipping these idols, people are really trying to find their ultimate security in a false hope. Sadly, a bit like my friend. This is how Martin Luther, I think, helpfully describes an idol. He says, whatever your heart clings to or relies on for ultimate security, that is your God. Whatever your heart clings to or relies on for ultimate security, that is your God. Paul, such a master of thinking about these situations, uses that opportunity, though, to proclaim Christ and the one true God in both the synagogue and the marketplace. He says, Acts 17, verse 24, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands. I like this. I think this is sarcastic. As if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. It's all about him. And having got their attention, he then preaches about Christ, his death, his resurrection, and his authority to judge the world in righteousness. And whilst some do sneer, amazingly, and it shouldn't amaze us, but friends, it does quite often, doesn't it? Some come to believe. See, just as Yahweh calls the people of Israel to be in an exclusive relationship with him alone as their God, just like a marriage, so Jesus also says to the same to all who believe in him. If you love me, that is, if you've come to believe in me as fully God and as your Savior, obey my commands. Live out in loving response the ways I am teaching you as your Lord. And this is the crux of the first command. Don't have divided loyalties. Rather, as Jesus quotes Deuteronomy 6, he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart. Heart at that time meant everything going on. All your soul, things going on outside of yourself. With all your mind, with what you think is going on. And with all your strength, everything that you think you can do. Love God with all of it. And in all you do, choose to follow the ways of Jesus and don't have a divided loyalty. That's the command. And yet one of the biggest barriers to us giving our full allegiance to God is our failure, I would suggest, to identify the gods we are really serving. And therefore, it's no surprise that we're told God is a jealous God. For in pouring out his immense love for us through Jesus Christ to bring us into relationship with him, his true love for us is wounded when he sees our desires and our loyalties are focused elsewhere. I mean, wouldn't we also be jealous if our treasured possession took little or no notice of us? Now let's just take a moment aside to consider the idea that those who turn away from God will cause their children to be punished for several generations. And let me offer you a couple of observations. Because the first is, we must remember that children are the care of their parents. And the life choices of parents have a very real impact on how others in their families live. Now, we rarely know any different environments from that we're raised in. And so often, those priorities and values that we experience in those formative years therefore carry forwards into the next generation. And so if parents worship idols, then why wouldn't their children too? And whilst Jeremiah 31 tells us that under the new covenant, generational sin is no more, for each is now held accountable before Christ and is offered forgiveness at the cross, the consequences of parental sin are still seen. I mean, consider this playing itself out today. If parents find security in money, it will also be likely that their children will follow suit and have security there too. If the need to be well educated is the security of that family, again, it will be natural for their children to also pass that on to theirs. Or if, when facing times of stress and strain, the parent turns to the bottle as a source of hope. You get the picture. However, there's a positive. For if a family takes the Lord at his word and teaches their children that Jesus can be trusted, then there is good hope that they will also learn to trust Jesus. Of course, we're always relying on them making their choice whether to do that for themselves or not. And here's the challenge. You see, idolatry can sneak up on us without us sometimes knowing. Because the New Testament tells us it's a heart problem. And if we don't keep our hearts in check on a regular basis, we'll soon find our priorities have shifted away from God first, and we did nothing to stop it. Take climbing the career ladder as an example. On one level, the developing of skills and taking on more responsibility is not an issue at all. And a healthy heart would offer this ambition back to God, asking him to help us progress so we can be a more positive influence in the workplace. However, over time, we can find such promotions squeeze out our time for worshiping Jesus. And we can start caring more about our career and doing those things than developing our relationship and maintaining it with Jesus. When this becomes the case, there's something very wrong. For our loyalty is now divided. And it can work the other way too, in that we can make idols out of positive things. You know, a church can make idols out of its history, out of its buildings, out of the influential people who have come before. And when they stop us moving forwards in Christ in worship or mission, these things have then become idols for the church. Or when we rely on a particular ministry, charity work, or hobby to validate us, then they too have slipped into being idols. Even our values can usurp Jesus when we decide enforcing them is more important than allowing them to flow out of our relationship with Jesus in loving others. See, the bottom line is anything that seeks to take the place of Jesus and our relationship with him, friends, is an idol. And we need to give the Holy Spirit free rein to smash the altars and images in our hearts so our loyalty is once again only to him. So I want to offer you some examples of some modern idols. I can't cover them all, but I want to offer you some just to try and trigger the thoughts, try and land it in a more practical place. So there's the idol of self. I'll be amazed if none of us have ever wrestled with this one. It's all about me. It's about promoting me. It's about caring for me. It's about what I look like more than it's about glorifying God. The idol of security. Are we placing our trust in Christ first, or in money, in work, in relationships, in reputation, even just in the control that we hold of any situation, because maybe we're just not trusting Jesus with it? The idols of approval or relationship. Whose opinion matters most? Does what our friends, our partners, our family think matter more than what God says? How much of our time are we willing to give to Jesus? Or how about the idol of health, wealth? Looking after ourselves and being wise is absolutely a really important thing. But when they take ultimate priority in our lives, they become idols. I mean, do we go to God or rely on our money to help us out? Do we give to him first or give to him out of the change after we've even enjoyed our Starbucks? Do we prioritize times of going to the gym, getting fit, doing sport, so much so that actually it pushes Jesus aside? Do we even dump church when time is short because we want to put other things first? And here's my last one for today. The idol of comfort. Do we choose the nice things over the God things? Do we stay in comfortable relationships rather than putting ourselves out to try and build new ones, however awkward, to share the gospel, to love one another? Do we prefer that extra hour of sleep instead of serving because that's our priority? Do we resist taking on a role or responsibility wherever God has called us because we think that we're ill-equipped? And yet God has clearly asked us and shown us that we could step into this role. Do we spend more on our luxuries than supporting a cause in desperate need of financial help? You see, friends, God doesn't offer these commandments to try and take away our fun, but rather to set us on the path of receiving the fullness of life found in him. Similarly, Paul desperately wanted the people to see that by worshipping false idols, they were getting a second-rate deal. Aside from the fact that they didn't work, he wanted them to find true hope, joy, and peace by encountering the risen Christ. And that same offer is made to us today, to allow the Holy Spirit to reveal to us the idols of our hearts and to smash them so that Christ is placed back at the center of our lives with undivided loyalty, having exclusive right, so that we might encounter the beauty of his loving kindness and the power of his Spirit enabling us to live in his ways. In a minute, we're going to come and gather around the table to share in communion. Again, another thing we don't want to turn into an idol, rather to receive as a gift from God. And so we're just going to take a moment to examine our own hearts, to invite the Spirit to reveal who is really in charge, who has exclusive rights to our lives. Is Jesus? Has he got that all access pass? Or are there competing idols holding areas that need confessing and smashing today? Just where you are, just take a moment, bow your head before God, speak to him now. In this space right now, we have the choice to engage with Jesus or just to resist him. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. See his love. See his grace. See his mercy that he wants to pour over you. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, our Lord. He just wants to draw you home. He just wants you to know how much he loves you. And the invitation is to welcome him in. To receive him afresh. To know that the Spirit will help you. No matter how hard the path may seem in your mind right now. Holy Spirit, come. Do a work in the hearts of all of us here today. We long to give you our undivided loyalty. And yet we are weak. But you are strong. So we trust not in ourselves. We trust in the power of Jesus. For here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as a flood. Let's sing together as a response to continuing in prayer. Sanctify us. It is He who has set us free. Those who are helping with communion, if you'd like to come, just sit on the front, that'd be helpful. And it's that freedom that allows us to gather around this table to share in this meal together as brothers and sisters in Christ in this place, but also as part of the global church. We don't eat this meal individually. We take part and join in with God's mission in this world. And if you love Jesus and you're seeking to follow Him, then you are invited to take part in this meal. It is up to you, though, if you're not comfortable or you just feel that you want to think about it a bit more. Please just let the elements pass by, just pass them on to the next person, and no one will challenge you on that at all. And if you've not been before, our wine is alcohol-free and our bread is gluten-free, and there are pre-packed cup and bread packets for those who would like a more COVID-safe approach. So come to this table. Not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because of any goodness of your own gives you the right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. Jesus said, "Listen, I am standing at the door and knocking. If any of you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into the house and eat with them, and they with me." That is the most awesome offer of all. A place at the table with the Lord Jesus. We're going to give thanks for the bread and for the wine. And Richard, would you mind coming and leading us in that prayer? Is that all right? Thank you.
Dear Father, we thank you for this opportunity, for the bread and the wine, a chance to think about ourselves and our situations and what you have done for us. In Jesus' name.
The Apostle Paul tells us of the institution of the Lord's Supper. "For what I have heard, I hand on to you," that came from the Lord Jesus himself, "that on the night of his arrest, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me. For every time you eat this bread and you drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And so, friends, I invite you, as the bread comes round, first of all, to take and just to eat the bread part, and to just take a moment, just in the still of the space, to just reflect on all Christ has done for you upon that cross. They all shared from one loaf, and they all shared from one cup. We don't drink individually, we don't eat individually, we are bound as members of the body of Christ. And so as the wine comes around, if you've already got a pre-packed cup, please just hold on to it. Otherwise, please take one of the wine, and we will drink together to show our unity in the body of Christ. Thank you. Friends, as we drink, may we remember that Christ's blood was shed for us and be thankful. Almighty God, we want to thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be living sacrifices. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work and be to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Fiona and Callum, do you want to come on up, please? Heather? On your last week, I may have broken our microphone. You can fix it for me. Callum, do you want to tell us why we've got you up here today?
For those of you who haven't met her, this is Fiona, my lovely fiancée, and we are moving back to Scotland next weekend for Fiona to start a new job and for myself to be transferred to my works office in Glasgow, hopefully. We're then getting married the weekend after. So lots of exciting things happening.
So what are those most stressful things that you should always do just one at a time?
I would just do them all at once.
All at once, just get it over with. Yeah, okay, fine, that's great. Well, we've loved having you as part of Community Fiona. It's been great to meet you and get to know you a little. You've been part of Chris and Heather's house group. That's how we'll name it for today. Claire and Heather would like to pray over you guys. If you want to maybe come forwards here and hand the mic over, and let's join in blessing them as they go from this place.
Thank you, Jesus, for Callum and Fiona. Thank you that you blessed us with them at this time. And now we ask you, Jesus, to go with them as they venture into this exciting life that they're going with them. Lord, you be with them in their relationship. So there is always three, that they will look to you and your word as they make all their decisions in life. Protect them in this new venture with the house move up to Scotland, and that the jobs are everything that they could imagine, Lord, and they were filled with people that give them joy and inspire them in your ways, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, Lord, we just thank you for Callum and his presence with us for the last 2 years and his work on the tech side up on the balcony, Lord. And we just thank you that he was able to join our house group for the last 18 months. Lord, we just pray a blessing on both of them for all the arrangements for the moving. Be with them, Lord. Help them to know your presence in all that they do. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Be blessed. Well, friends, as we draw to the end of our time together, I'm just going to offer a couple of prayers for things going on in the world before we respond by declaring that Jesus is our vision for all that we face in all that we do. So let's just pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for that reminder in your word that you are sovereign over everything, that nothing is missed out of your sight, that you are one who is present in all situations. And Lord, whilst you never promise to take away the situation, you do promise to always be there, to never leave or forsake us. And so if we start by just thinking about one another and the challenges that we may know going on within our own lives, within the lives of our friends and family, within the lives of those in this church community, Father, would you pour out your blessing on them? Would they know your peace? Lord, would they know your healing? Lord, would you help them to know your presence, be that in a very supernatural way or through those you gather around them? Would you help them to know that they are loved and they are seen, and that they are held. As we look at our country and indeed out towards the world, Lord, we recognize there are so many tensions, so many issues going on, and many beyond our understanding. And Lord, we do admit it's hard to know how to pray. Yet, Father, we lift up those people at the moment to you who have lost loved ones in tragic circumstances, be that through earthquakes or flood or war, be that through seeking to find refuge as a refugee. We lift up to you those who are struggling to make ends meet day to day. And we thank you that we may be in a position to be alongside those people. Help us to be wise. Help us to use words of encouragement to build them up. Thank you that we live in a country which still gives money in support of people in those situations. But we see on the news day to day many countries where they face such pain and poverty and hunger because there is no sort of support system in place at all. So we pray your blessing and guidance on those charities and NGOs who are working in those countries, seeking to be good news. And in particular for those Christians who seek to help people realize that Jesus is their ultimate hope. Father, for each and every situation, would you be our vision? Would we turn to you and seek your path? And may you be glorified for all that goes on. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's stand together if you're able as we sing our closing song, declaring that Jesus is our vision. He is the King of all our hearts. Thanks, Trevor.
Oh,
So friends, go into God's word world with joy and peace and love and hope in your hearts. And the blessing of Almighty God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, our first love, be with you all, wherever you go and in whatever you do. Amen. Amen.